I am Meenu Bagla and I am a lead marketing expert. I have been with technology industry for last 20 years in various brand marketing and strategy leadership roles. I have pretty much spent substantial part of my career helping brands like Oracle, Wipro, Tech Mahindra and multiple startups establish lean global marketing and communication functions with digital and MarTech at the center of it. Marketers globally have spent last 60 days in doing multiple and myriad of things. Most of us have been doing internal and external crisis communication, business to community outreach, and creating new manuals of communication, collaboration, and marketing. Now let's dive in and see what's the next 60 days and beyond will look like for us. Are we going to evolve into a new breed of function? How will our repeated context change the contours of our function? How do we elevate customer experience in the next normal? If not now, when is the right time to invest in high-tech, high-touch, digital, and experience technologies? I'm sure there are a zillion of questions on our mind and on our markets, messaging, media, measurement, across industries and across regions. Thank goodness I don't have to answer all of them. We have a great set of panelists who are here to answer some of these very complex and pertinent questions. And without much ado, let me introduce you to our eminent panelists. We have Alistair McIntyre Curry. He is Vice President Marketing for Asia Pacific and Japan at VM Software. Previously with Nokia and Riverbed, he has more than 20 years of experience in technology, marketing, communications, and business development. And he's proud that he has lived and worked in many countries around the world, including India. Our second panelist, Rajesh Kumar. He is Chief Marketing Officer for India and South Asia UiPath. Prior to this, he has worked with companies like SAP, Microsoft, HCL, Perfetti, and Pernod. And he has closely seen the evolution of marketing and tech industry in Asia Pacific over the last two decades. And we also have with us Venu Gopal Ganganna. He is CEO of Langur, Chief Digital Officer of Havas Digital, a part of the Havas Media Group. He has over 21 years of experience in the field of digital marketing, business development, IT delivery, resource and performance management, and client engagement. We will have an interesting and engaging Q&A at the end of this discussion. And with that, let me jump into our first question. Alistair, how do you see COVID-19 impacting business and marketing at this moment in your context?
It's been a crazy time. Everyone's been impacted. You know, every facet of our society has been impacted in any way, shape, or form. You can say from business, from any industry, travel, our personal lives, our social lives, our family lives. There's just unprecedented, and I think that's one of the critical things. Which is, when we're talking about the next normal, I think the next normal will take any. Frankly, it's going to be a very personal next normal, I think. It's these kinds of times, though, where the significant change, these are the forcing functions that prompt the need to look at ourselves as human beings, as professionals, and think about what it means for us to be better people, better marketers, better business people, better everything. This is the lesson that we have to take from this. Every country is going through this kind of relax, tighten, and I think that's going to be our next normal for the next, I believe, 6, 12, 18 months, because it's just not going to be anything predictable, I think, from in any country around the world. But I think it's how we look at how we change some of our business, you know, our business models, how we look at where we work, the times we work. I think we'll all agree that there was no 9-to-5 anyway beforehand. There's definitely no 9-to-5 now. It's a 24/7 shift, basically. It's just constant. So I think, you know, this is impacting the way we have to sell, how we have to market, how we consume, how we purchase as well. And I think that's what we're going to have to just try and adapt to. And I think trying to find our own personal next normal, which will be ourselves, but also our teams, the companies we work in. How do we interact? How do we engage? And that transformation around every route to market we look at from a marketing perspective, the mix, the tactics, the concepts, the innovation, the flexibility, the adaptability. I think that's driving. Every business has to shift. Every marketing function has to shift. And I think it's those inflection points that change what we've done before. We saw that with Airbnb disrupting, Uber disrupting taxis and hotels and everything else. This is disrupting I think just every single business, and it's challenging, it's tough, it's impacting so many people in terrible ways, and but there's always opportunity for that, and our job is to come back stronger as businesses and as professionals.
So rightly said, Alistair. You know, I could hear three words very loud and clear in your answer. It's unprecedented, it's unpredictable, and it's very personal. So it's going to be different, right, for everyone, for everybody's context. You know, that brings me to my second question. And Rajesh, this is for you. In this unprecedented, unpredictable personal change or shift, how do you see the JD emerging for CMOs? Is that going to be a new rule book?
This is time to live your JD. I don't think you need to reinvent your JD, because CMO's JD, in my mind, always has been a business leader with a marketing expertise in their domain. And like Alistair said, these are unprecedented times, you know, and this is personal again. I think it's imperative on CMOs to step up and take role of the strategic, you know, chaperone in the organization. The different functions are super busy handling other things like, you know, legal, HR, sales, manufacturing, because they are dealing with a lot. And I think it's an opportunity for CMOs, and not only CMOs, marketing teams, to assess the situation, see what needs to be done as a business, and take charge to put that in place. So, you know, for example, I can share example in our business, where we set up a crisis management team within about, you know, 3 or 4 days of this hitting. And it's interesting, today is actually, from my count, it's week 19 since COVID-19 crisis hit. Right? So we actually set up a, you know, crisis management team, which is across a step back and looked at the whole response. And, you know, it didn't look like a classical marketing response. It looked like, what do we need to do as an organization? How do we live our values? You know, how do we show what our mission is, you know, which for technology companies usually tends to be help change the world or help make the world better. So the larger issues when it is facing humanity is how as an organization or as a business, you're going to support your community and, you know, nation. How are you going to support your employees for their, you know, health and well-being and to be productive? And then how are you helping your customers and partners? You know? And that, I think, is a larger charter which CMOs can step up. And many things come out of it, which are not in your day-to-day job. In many ways, people want to do those things when, you know, in normal times. But this presents an interesting opportunity to do so. You know, we provided a lot of solutions for governments and public institutions to solve their, you know, challenges using technology, you know, serving them remotely, which turned out very interesting. And, you know, not only it helped the organizations and the community outside, but it had a tremendous positive impact on morale of employees. You know, being helpful in a situation like this is a huge booster. You know, it changes the way you think about things, right? And then from an employee's perspective, normally tech companies are set up to work remotely. But something like this, when you're in almost isolation for many, many weeks, is unprecedented. So tech is sorted out, but human aspects come to the fore. Productive, they are engaged, they're not feeling isolated. You know, many organizations are reporting issues relating to mental health. So how do you set that whole thing in place? You know, how do you look at the human side of it? A lot of actions there. Again, as you, and again, you know, there is no silver bullet, but as you do many of these things and people come forward and share what they are doing, you know, those set up a great example for others to emulate. And then you start looking at, they're dealing with setting their employees for success, work from home. And they are dealing with their own supply chains and their, you know, continuity of customer orders and service and so on and so forth. And then you start, you know, looking at, firstly, how do you touch them, connect with them, understand what they need, you know, and then start getting to them or helping them in a relevant manner. So we, for example, try to understand those and created about 40 use cases in a 4-week period, which were very specific to a COVID situation. And we started sharing. And simple things like an employee health tracker would be bought. We started offering many of those free. So those things have worked. So it kind of tells you, you know, it's a very interesting opportunity, although not a, you know, not the easiest of times, but huge opportunity for CMOs to step up and sort of, you know, live their title in my mind.
I think you said it in your first line itself, Rajesh, we got to live our journey. And as we live, we are writing our journey. I don't think so. These are times where you can just sit back and write it out and then, you know, live it, right? Thank you so much, Rajesh. I think this was a very enriching insight. That brings me to somebody who has been living and breathing digital for a while now. Venu, from your vantage point, do you see digital becoming the core lever of brand and business development? I mean, literally people are talking about that digital is the path to recovery. You know, share your perspectives, your, you know, your experiences and insights, and maybe some examples of what you have done for your customers.
Alistair and Rajesh, following up on your thoughts, I took unpredictability and reliving your journey, not living, but reliving your journey. I think my world has always come from a place of how do I turn unpredictability to predictability? How do I educate the marketeers to relive always, right? So with that context, do we see digital becoming the core lever of brand and business development? Finally, it is. Finally, digital has arrived. You have seen the memes floating around saying COVID-19 is the biggest digital transformation trigger agents across the world, and it is very true. But as marketeers, I think we need to take a step back, not get caught up in this noise of everything is going digital. It's be the end all and be all. Instead of that, if you take a step back, I always believed in there is no other truth than data. There is no other truth than behaviors of consumers and intent of consumers, right? Digital fortunately gives you that roadway to find the truth. That's when we say, like, okay, because of post-COVID, if everything has become digital, what does that mean? For example, in India, over the last probably 14-15 months, average monthly visits to digital platforms in India is around 15 billion visits a month. 15 billion. Come March and April, it's 21 billion visits. So the shift from 15 to 21 billion is massive, massive shift. So then the question comes, where is this shift happening, right? How can I go into looking at health and wellness, entertainment, gambling, gaming, IV industry? So if you start splitting those, the truth emerges very, very differently. One would think that, like, probably e-commerce and shopping has completely flew out of the roof on digital, but it's actually other way around. They have dropped, the e-commerce and the shopping world, which is the true digital world, has dropped 35% over the last 2 months from a traffic perspective. So what it looks like, it is actually not. As marketers, the capability to go to the underlying data, underlying consumer behavior, and finding those white spaces and trends and hypothesizing of which one will stay put and which one will not, is where the biggest bet will come from. For example, one would say health and wellness is crazy. That's the biggest shift we have seen, and that's absolutely true. And in that, if you slice and dice, anything related to lung health and smoking has taken over. Anything related to holistic living has taken over. Anything related to Ayurveda has taken over. But anything related to pharma, anything related to regular medicines has dropped. Anything related to nutrition has taken over. So how do you, one, analyze and say, out of this 21 billion noises, 21 billion movements in India, which ones is relevant to my business? Which ones are not, right? That's the first thing. Second one is, one would think that the non-essentials on digital also is not growing, so the behaviors won't change. But what we have seen is, in non-essentials, a lot of behavioral transition has happened from marketplace to brand.com. So if there is one advice I'm going to put to marketeers, saying this is the time to reinvest on brand.com, because surprisingly, consumers are now going to, I don't care what Amazon says, if a brand.com says, I want to create a relationship and I want to build that. It's a big shift, and we need to leverage that, right? And then, so brand.com becomes important. Data, understanding the data and which behavior will stay put will become important. A couple of more examples of a lot of our customers, we are influencing them to say create products around digital queuing, because digital queuing is the future of the world now, right? So how can hospitals to dermatologists to a basic doctor to anybody who is in the business of customer service can create digital queuing? It's immense how much focus has already gone into that. So you stay at your house, you put your information into a digital queuing system, and the system wakes you up and says, in 10 minutes come, your appointment is set. That's already taken over in India in multiple folds. Then another favorite example is the ID Fresh Food, who was in the business of doing batter, just idli and vada batter. They have taken digital to the forefront of saying, I'm going to tell my consumers as soon as a product hits their local stores. So they have connected the supply chain using technology, and a message goes out to consumers saying there's a fresh batter. I'm like, unbelievable how, because they wanted to maintain the social distance in the stores. So that is there. You're seeing examples of Cipla, who is into consumer pharma and RX, collaborating with Zomato to deliver. We are seeing on the B2B world, everything has moved from experiential marketing to ABM marketing, right? ABM marketing, I think we as marketeers were trying to tell B2B over the last 4 years saying, please go ABM. I think it was all about, I will make sure I will run an event. I'll make sure the bums are on the seat. That's how B2Bs are run. From that to ABM is a big shift. So understand the data, understand the behaviors that will stay put depending on the trends. Invest in digital queuing, invest in connecting technology using the supply chain, partnerships, and most importantly, all this can be enabled because digital is at the forefront by connecting 4 or 5 pieces. I don't think you need to reinvent anything. Everything is out there. So connect everything. That's where digital becomes core of the brand and business development.
Very interesting, Venu. The headline messages that I hear from three of you is, you know, while we are in the recovery phase, the world out there or the future out there is still very unpredictable, very uncertain. And, you know, there is no such one global context anymore. I think every region, every segment, every person has his own or her context. The second is, if we marketers need to survive and thrive in that context, we really need to live our JD instead of, you know, creating new rule books and then implementing. I think we are literally implementing as we are creating the JD. And very rightly said, Venu, I think brands that will be able to intelligently predict on the shifts in consumer behavior as a result of this are going to not just survive but thrive. And you know, interestingly, from my vantage point, when I see across the whole B2B, B2C spectrum, you know, there are some behaviors, as you rightly said, that will come back to normal. Okay, they might have gone digital for some time, but they will come back to normal. There is a second set of behavior which is very exciting. You know, which was very exciting when the whole lockdown period started globally. It was the whole webinar and, you know, the video conferencing. But I guess we all are, you know, understand now the fatigue of it. And we're all craving to meet each other, you know, the human touch. There are certain behaviors, as you rightly said, like the Cipla's of the world. The behavior of healthcare and safety in consumer has a potential to stick on for a very long time. And I think brands that understand that and that will, you know, customize or personalize or create products and experiences around it are going to thrive. Interesting segment for me to look at are segments which are literally replacing the so-called traditional in-person experiences. And I think, you know, I'm just thinking out loud here, maybe they will come in travel and hospitality, you know, because I don't see a lot of us doing leisure travel for a very long time now. Most of us, even after the airports have opened, you know, whether here or, you know, in America where the airports have been open, you know, I think we will take some time to change that. And will that change the pivot of the industry itself? Very interesting insight from you, Venu. Alistair, back to you. So, you know, with this whole change of context and digital coming at the forefront, from your vantage point, do you see marketing in its traditional sense on a pause? Or in the last 60 days, did you see marketing in a very fast forward way? And was marketing on the periphery of business, or do you see much more heightened expectation from business on marketing in the next 60 to, you know, 120 days?
I don't think there's been fast forward. I don't think marketing has been on anything but fast forward since middle of January. It's fast anyway. since week three of the year. So you walk into 2020 thinking, right, I've got a plan, here's a direction, I've got my core philosophy, tactics, here's what we're going to do. And my colleague Nikhil in India has been redoing everything pretty much every single day since the end of January. My China team basically started, I mean, we're on lockdown from January the 26th, basically around Chinese New Year. And from there, cascading all the way through Asia Pacific and Japan, through every market, is being replanned. So the entire 2020 plan just went, whoop, you know, out the window. And we kind of went, right, how do we redo things? How do we innovate? How do we do something different? You know, we had 60% of our Q1 activities taken down. Those, you know, the expectation is adapt, overcome. That's the basic expectation for in any business, right? Our job is to say, well, hang on, that didn't work. What are we going to do? We're doing the A/B testing anyway, every single day of the week. We're doing the same thing now in terms of our entire strategy, our execution. We're talking about, you know, relive, rewrite, redo every single part of your JD every single day. Yep, job one. Yep, fine. That's a Monday, you know. And then, you know, you're going into all the data. You're trying to find different ways. You're trying to innovate, stand out online. You're trying to do all these different things. A couple of other things in terms of advice, in terms of what we're trying to do as well. But I think expectations are high anyway over all functions, and marketing especially, because marketing is a function of sales, or sales is a function of marketing. Whichever way you look at the world, we all need to work together to come together to basically drive the business forward, to do the things we need to do for owners, shareholders, employees, everybody, so we continue to drive the business forward and find new ways of doing business during, you know, during this time and into the future, in whatever, you know, and anyone's personal or anyone's business next normal is going to be. I think fast forward might be understating it. I think more like Star Wars hyperspeed, you know, just absolutely, you know, everyone has been racing at a million miles an hour, I think, trying to not only digest what's happening around them personally, professionally, but also sort of take things down and redo them and then replan them. And it's been incredibly hard work for everybody. A couple of pieces of advice, you know, as we try and think about this and try and think as marketers as well, which is pause, breathe. That's the hardest thing to do at the moment. And anyone in my team, and don't ask them, but pausing and breathing for me is the hardest thing to do, but it is pause and breathe, right? It's just what's going on, right? We had Gilchrist on a all hands call about 4 weeks ago, talking about how when they were on a tour of England, Adam Gilchrist, you know, on a tour of England, and the English were doing something completely different, and everybody was questioning themselves because they, you know, we're so good, you know, and suddenly they were confronted by change, by uncertainty. And he said a really interesting thing, which has stuck in my mind, you know, all the time, which is, how many hours, how many days, weeks, months, years have all of us as marketers, as business people, been doing what we're doing and have been learning things every single day? Weeks, months, decades. I wouldn't say it, but probably about a century's worth of experience sitting around just, you know, just in terms of the panel here today. Remember the basics. In the time of crisis, you will challenge yourself. You will question everything, but apply the normal principles you would use to do anything. Think it through. Yes, think innovatively. We have to do that. You can try fast, fail, A/B test it. Try this, didn't work. Okay, did I learn something from that? Yeah, great. Build on that knowledge. So I think those are the things that I think are fundamentally important right now more than ever. Understanding where you are, knowing that you know this in some way, shape or form. And if you don't know it, I don't have all the answers. My team and anybody will tell you, I don't know all the answers. I don't have all the answers. But amongst all of you around the table on virtual meetings, conferences, webinars, everything else between you, you have all the answers. It's that power of team that is fundamentally important. Stand out in the market, get innovative, try things, you know, and just do your basics. Identify, execute, iterate, innovate, just keep going.
I thought so, Alistair. You know, it will be probably a hyper-speed level marketing activities at your end. You know, that brings me to an interesting question, which is more outside in. Rajesh, over to you for this. Do you see this is fundamentally changing the expectations of different stakeholders from marketing? I mean, let's face it, you know, there were certain fundamentals of marketing function, principles of marketing functions, touch points of marketing function. But you know, seems like that's all been thrown out of the window, and the expectations have changed completely.
Just a clarification, Meenu, when you say stakeholders, you mean internal, external, or both?
You know, my first, maybe you can answer it in two phases. The first is, you know, does the CEO see the function differently, right? So the internal stakeholders and even the external stakeholders, you know, for example, Rajesh, you pointed out in your earlier answer that, you know, it was no longer limited to just customer marketing. You were working with the government, you were working with communities, you were working with partners and so on, which were not necessarily the core marketing function traditionally, right? So both internal and external, Rajesh.
So I'm going to pick up from where I left in the last question. I think part of the answer lies there. I think the stakeholders themselves are trying to deal with this unprecedented change, and they have a number of challenges, you know, in terms of, like I said, keeping the business afloat, you know, keeping your customers and partners connected, taking care of employees and so on and so forth. Right? So, like I said before, I think marketing is, you know, at this point of time, I see a smaller part of the expectation. But the larger challenge is, who are we going to be as a company, and you know, how do we get there? I think that is where marketing comes in. And again, like I said, I don't think it was ever not there, but somehow in a regular day-to-day rhythm, the operational rigor and the multitude of things take over. You get so tied down with them, that becomes the overriding perception or frame people tend to see marketing in. With something like this, where everything becomes irrelevant, I mean, people like us spent many months last year to build an annual plan for this year. But suddenly, poof, it's gone, right? But while it hurts that your effort is not, you know, seeing light of the day, but it also makes sense and opens a new door of opportunity to do something different, to look at things afresh. So I see, you know, these, when I look at the stakeholders, and I would sort of at this point combine internal and external and say, you know, what are the three areas I see expectations coming from, right? And this is sort of my synthesis, because also external customers are also, and partners are also, seeing for relevance. You know, nobody wants to be subjected to the same tarot again, which they have no time for. So essentially, I think first part is, you know, how do you connect and keep your brand relevant to your, you know, larger ecosystem, customers and partners. Having a brand purpose has been beaten around quite a bit over last, you know, few years. We saw early in the cycle people having some very clever advertisements with a play with their logo and so many other things, right? But really, what are you actually going to do? Are you going to walk your talk? And I think those have, you know, very long-lasting consequences, how people see and connect with your brand. You know, just telling is not enough. And you can see how different brands are responding, you know, to the crisis very differently. Of course, you know, companies exist for a commercial purpose, but when there is a larger, you know, challenge, you can see, you know, how you see a Tata differently, who stepped up and done everything, for many other brands who probably haven't focused and just focus on the commercial aspects of business, right? You are going to see them differently. So that's number one. Second, I think large part of the marketing, and more so in B2B, and which I think Alicia spoke about, and Venu alluded as well when he spoke about experiential and, you know, ABM. I think it's really to marketing is sort of the holder of the demand, you know, demand creation, progression and maturation, right? And we have to look at a life beyond tactics. Sometimes, you know, when we start discussing events versus webinars versus, you know, those are all tactics. You have a large arsenal, you use what fits, and for the purpose it fits, right? Tactics is not, you know, marketing, in my opinion. So you have to really see, like in our business, you know, which segment's business is growing. If airline or a specific industry is actually having a tough time, it's unrealistic to go and, you know, start working with them on something new. You might help them with large volumes of calls for cancellation or ticket changes coming in via automation. You know, our bots can do that, and we saw in many cases. But you want to look at industries which are going to grow, right? And then again, there is no one size fits all. You need to be precise about your segmentation, which industry, which size of companies, which geographies will actually grow. And focus your effort there. What is your ability to mature or consume that demand. You might build a large pipe, but if customers are busy, you know, handling their current situation and not really moving that forward, then there is no point building fresh and trying to, you know, fill it, because it will go stale. So you have to sort of sanitize, bring reality home. How much do you really need, and what's the most effective way to do so? That's sort of the second thing I would say. Third, I think in my mind, is working on what's the next normal likely to be. In reality, you know, nobody knows, right? There are various, you know, points of view. There are various ways of analyzing the future. And I think, to me, that's why forums like this are important, because we are together building it in situations like this. And I've probably participated in more conversations now than ever before, and I'm glad I did. You know, I'm trying to read as much as I can, various reports and so on coming in, because usually, you know, we tend to comment everything on social media, we don't tend to read it, right? I think this is time to read it, digest it, and try to see pattern, connect the dots, and leverage peers like we have on this, and to be able to paint that picture forward for your organization. And lastly, it's not the nicest thing to say, but I think this is a time when you want to run your ship very tight. You want to conserve cash, you want to, you know, manage resources well, and, you know, get scrappy if you're not already, so that you have a longer, you know, lifeline for your function, and you are helping your organization stay agile, stay resilient, and doing things smartly.
That's definitely the most pragmatic and practical point of view, Rajesh, in today's times. You know, that brings me to another pertinent question we all have been hearing and you know, trying to respond to in our own context. Venu, I know you, and I probably am asking, you must be thinking, why is this woman asking me only digital questions? I do many more things. But right now, the statements that's hovering in my head is that, you know, everybody, every country, every region, every government is talking about localize, 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 because the global supply chains are much more hit or much more struggling than the local supply chain. And, you know, especially in India, we are talking about that hyperlocal is the new global. Now, do you see digital and social media platforms play an important part in this movement? You know, if I see the audience of our webinar, there's a huge chunk of our audience which is from India, but they are from elsewhere as well. So it'd be great if you can throw some perspective of how do you see this in Indian context, and then maybe take up another region and see how it plays out.
The importance of being hyper-local was always there. The situation has just enhanced it very further. There are two pieces on trying to figure out what hyper-local means. I think this has been the buzzword for many years, but I think a lot of marketers brands were using it for the sake of it, but now they need to really do it. When one needs to do it, there are two pieces. One is, how do I understand the hyper-local needs? And the second one is to, am I capable enough to deliver to those needs, right? So two pieces.
There's one more lever of this question is that, you know, in today's blurred lines of, you know, differentiation between local and global, I'm sure if we do a brand quiz with the audience today, you know, 90% of us which would not know what's actually local and what's a global or the so-called non-local brand. I think that's also one perspective. It'd be great to hear from you.
One of my favorite example is, you're a brand trying to win in the dog world of insurance in India. Most insurance is sold in India and never bought, which means it's the most expensive way to bring customers on board if you are an insurance brand. So what does hyperlocal mean for a brand like that? So hyperlocal may mean that, like, am I smart enough to understand where the demand is coming from? Am I smart enough to understand the demand is coming from in their language, in their vocabulary, in their life cycle? While everybody knows that, most of the brands go and fight for term insurance, life insurance in digital, try to get into that journey of consumers, bring them onto the board, right? Instead, if you go just opposite, and one of the example is, if you just go in Telugu, if you try and understand who's looking for Jeevan Bima, right? That word is more traffic compared to life insurance in English. Wow. And zero challenge, zero bidding for that keyword. That means if I want, as a brand, I want to enter, I can just get free pass of all those consumers coming to me. And irrespective of how many times we tell this to brands, they say like, I think it won't work. I think I don't want to fight that battle. So they end up spending thousands and millions of dollars fighting against each other instead of trying and figuring out hyperlocal means what. Hyperlocal in Kerala means very different thing. Hyperlocal in Bhojpuri means very different thing. So that's one. Okay, if you do good to understand that hyperlocal need, I think a lot of brands struggle on how to serve it then. The serving piece is where the technology and experience is coming. So gone are those days probably where you bring and understand multiple different hyperlocal needs and bring them to your digital communication and assets, which seems like only one tone. Whether the need is 16,000 different behaviors and needs, they give one shop saying, here is my home page. You go like this, you explore, be my guest. That doesn't work. If you want to enable the hyperlocal needs, you need to enhance your digital platforms to serve 16,000 different behaviors, because they're all coming with 16,000 different intents. You need to have 16,000 different way of presenting yourself in real time. Fortunately, the technologies of today does that very easily. But for a lot of brands, this is a very complex world. I think they get mixed up with AI, ML, and all of that. And as Alistair said, pause, breathe, take a step back. You can solve this in a very simple way. That's one. Another one of my favorite example is there's a company called Okal. Okay, a lot of people don't know. They've got close to the same monthly active users as TikTok. Okay, same monthly active users. It's a startup based out of Bangalore. Their only quest is to answer voice questions outside of tier 1 cities in India. That's all they said, like, everybody in hyperlocal don't know how to search in Google. They're going to pick up the phone and say, how do I pass IIT and go to Bombay and find a job? That is the single largest question of rural India today. Zero marketing budgets. It has got 120 million active users. Now they are going into, okay, if I know this, can I create a Kannada Twitter? So last month they just launched Kannada Twitter, and it's already above the number of Twitter subscribers in Karnataka, you know, just 30 days. And it's called Koo, K-O-O, Koo. That's it. It's a local, hyperlocal need, understood very well and served. So understand the hyperlocal need, but to serve them, you need to bring tools and technologies together.
Thank you, Venu, so much. I think we have a barrage of questions coming in. So I was thinking maybe we can, you know, take 5 minutes to answer some of those interesting questions from the audience. How do we get MNCs to cater the local demands in the chain scenario? And it's a question asked by Mr. Sachidanand Chaturvedi.
If you are a large B2B MNC, instead of saying, I'm going to go aggressively in the local markets and win it, I'm seeing a shift where they're saying, I'm going to enable my local partners at the first level. So there was always, in these large B2Bs, there were local partnership programs, the gold, silver, platinum programs and everything. But with the advent of this scenario, the MNCs are realizing, I think, let us enable them. I think because the sentiments are that way, right? So if I truly enable my channel partners in more meaningful way, invest more in the pilots, enable them to market themselves better, anyway, the business is going to come, but it's going to come through a face of my channel partner. I see that shift very magically happening. Otherwise, they were always just a partner over there. Now they are feeling it as a true extension.
Yeah, I was going to say, Vito, 100%. I mean, we've been basically training and enabling thousands of partners across Asia Pacific, Japan, and globally all the way through this. It's just an opportunity because people are going, well, what do I do?
Yeah.
Get trained, get relevant. And to your point, Vito, I mean, getting for any business, finding those pockets of, well, not, it's not a pocket of growth when you've got 120 million subscribers, basically, just by focusing outside of tier two. One of the things that MNCs need to really understand, the hyperlocal question, I'm an MNC, but the fact is that local relevance, use case, market, the context, you know, I'm about to type my answer, but the contextual marketing, as you talked about, Venu, as well, we've all talked about, which is understanding the market you see and you want to play in, and how do you fit into that and do that right. And I think that getting local, understanding the market, is even more empowering locally, the sales, the SEs, the channel team, the alliance team, the marketers, to go, I see something.
Absolutely.
I need to go after that.
The second one, interestingly, is what do marketing heads need to learn to incorporate AI in marketing and any technology that they need to learn? That's a question asked by Amitava Kundu.
AI is a very broad area. Usually, we tend to have some unrealistic expectations from any technology. So I'd first like to temper those. I think, you know, if you haven't understood the problem, no technology in the world is going to solve it. So we can't put the cart before the horse, right? Now, having said that, I think technology is going to do a few things. It is going to help you do things at a much faster pace with a much more scalability. And, you know, in the current scenario where manual handoff or a face-to-face interaction is a challenge, it's going to help you, you know, solve a lot of things without that, you know, without you facing the problem, right? At the same time, you know, though I'm in technology industry, but it's quite, you know, obvious to me that AI is not going to replace human intelligence in any near future time, you know, and all the science fiction be damned, which tends to form the popular perception we have, you know, of technology. And I'll give you some specific scenarios. And I'll also give you my call out for marketers. When I look at the data, I see technology increasingly getting, you know, adopted, including AI, and you can sort of look at machine learning models under that, because they power the AI and then you train the models, right? Is marketers as a function are behind every other function in the organization in adopting technology. Right? As much as we speak, we don't do it. And when we do it, we tend to devolve it on somebody else. So I think maybe if there is one takeaway all marketers want to take, is go take a refresher course in all the any new technology, AI or anything else. Now there is a time. If nothing else, take a very simple one on something like LinkedIn learning. It will take hour and a half. But at least, you know, it puts a context. For example, the case I mentioned of an airline ticket change, right? And how AI helps. Now, in a situation when there are not enough people, right? And you have different requests coming in. So if the requests are coming through any kind of text messages, AI can put in semantic logic to understand via keywords what kind of nature or problem you are having. If that tallies with the standard answers, you know, below or in the database or in the knowledge base, they're going to pull that out and provide it to you. Today, if there is a bot connected to it, it's actually going to go and activate that in your backend. Maybe there is an ERP system or there is a payment system. For example, you cancel a ticket, you'll take your cancellation, it'll go tally. It's not only like a chatbot chat with you, but it'll actually go in the backend and, you know, cancel your ticket and instruct the money to be credited to your bank, which is a boon when people are not there, which is what a lot of airlines we are working with. Because suddenly with this crisis coming in, you know, everybody is rushing to change their tickets or cancel their tickets. They can't humanly handle it. And this becomes a challenge even when people are there. When people are not there, it's crazy, right? But a typical bot, for example, will do work 8 to 10 times a person. And the bots, fortunately, are not impacted by anything like COVID. They don't need to eat, sleep. So they can work continuously. So those kind of things are happening. Things which cannot be solved in a manner like this, the AI will be able to identify severity of the problem, you know, based on the language used in your, in your message, or by the tone of your voice if you're on a, you know, phone call, right? And accordingly, they are going to route you in order of priority to different people, right? And there has been a challenge of people accessing customer data from home locations. So the new technology solutions, some of those we are working on, actually mask personally identifiable information when an agent accesses it, right? So those kind of things, it comes in, you know, then provide you a response. So it helps you scale indefinitely, because then all you need to do is deploy more technology. You know, it's not like hiring, onboarding, training people. So these are the kind of, you know, situations that come in. It can help you in many, many ways, but I would say, make a start and see where you want to point your gun to before you start shooting.
Personalization, scale, democratization, and, you know, start, you know, with small steps, right? That's what I hear from you, Rajesh. Thank you so much on that. You know, I see this one question somebody asked. Sorry, I'm not able to see the name of the person. And I think this is something we discussed, Rajesh, Alistair, and Beno, in the beginning of our conversation. Is that why the B2B world is moving to ABM? there is still going to be a huge shift on experiential marketing and use of digital in that for industries that were completely dependent on experiences, right? Whether it's travel, yeah. hospitality, etc. I leave it open to all three of you, Alistair, Venu, Rajesh, whoever want to answer that question. I personally believe it's going to be a huge potential for growth. I think industries who have put the AR, VR and experiential technology at the back burner are really going to realize the importance of it. And, you know, while, you know, when Tesla was doing this and people were mocking it, I think we realize the importance of it now.
Yeah.
So over to you, panelists. Yeah. Any of you who want to answer that question? I think it's a very interesting question.
I just said it, contextual marketing. ABM, as Venu's been saying, we've all been doing it. ABM is just the optimal mix of data, targeting, where you want to be, who you want to talk to, and building that together with a variety of tactics. I love what Rajesh said. You know, a webinar is not marketing, it's not a campaign, it's a tactic and a campaign and a program and a goal. Everything is a combination of all these things working together. So what I would say is the customer journey is fundamentally important. In the current world, innovate to stand out online, because there's 10.5 billion webinars going on a day and everyone's going, I've got a webinar. Apart from this one, because this one's special because we're on it. But it's really important that we are 100% thinking creatively. We've got our global VeeamON conference, which is normally in Vegas. Well, 2 weeks ago, it's going virtual, middle of June, the whole thing. So trying to find ways to just shift and adapt. And that will become the next one as we go through.
I think those five things where we were trying to explain the B2B experience marketeers to do is real now. The formula we are trying to figure out now is with the overload of information, experiential marketing future is these five pillars. Please bring in and weave a cause now into this mix. Personalize it, create a little bit of hybrid experience, a little bit of immersive experience. Most importantly, create a document style narrative, not a very one-way series of it, and make it seamless. That's the future of experience marketing.
I don't think, you know, life becomes completely black or white at any point of time. I think we always did value and will value experience. You know, the mix will probably change. I think more use of digital and AI and, you know, other technologies will come in to deliver it. So I think, again, a hybrid world with a bit more, you know, tilt towards the digital. And I think, you know, at some point things are going to come back and people are going to yearn for social contact, for, you know, physical experiences. So I think, but definitely this crisis will help accelerate the shift and, you know, at least for some time move it strongly towards that.
It's a question that somebody asked, that how do premium brands show the sense of purpose in these times?
Sense of purpose, social purpose, business purpose,
community purpose. I mean, one of the examples comes to my mind is Louis Vuitton turned all of its factories into sanitizer making, you know, factories, right? And they started to contribute locally. Mm-hmm. So I don't think it really matters.
100%. I think it is. We talked about it right at the very beginning, which is how are we going to change? Not just as companies, as professionals, but as people as well. I think every company needs to be looking, you know, and a lot of companies are. We've got, you know, we work with a very, very large brand in India who has been retooling and doing, you know, making hand sanitizers and everything else, because that is the right thing to do. One of the benefits that come out of this crisis is that we realize the human elements, the human aspect are craving for human interaction, but how do we behave as human beings to each other, to the planet? And in general, I think that would be my optimistic approach and aspiration for everybody to have that sense of purpose and come out of this differently.
Absolutely, Alistair. I think whether you are a premium or a mass or a niche brand, it really doesn't matter. I think the principles of humanity remains the same, right? I think we are on top of the hour and we will not be able to take all of the questions, but we would love to stay connected on social media channels and maybe answer those questions online. I would take this opportunity to thank each of our panelists and each of the audience members who listened in and who have been interacting and engaging and asking us questions and keeping us relevant. Clearly, do we have all the answers? No, we don't. I think we are all living and making the history as we go. As Alistair rightly said, it's still uncertain, it's still unpredictable, but still there is an opportunity to build and reimagine business. You know, as Rajesh really pointed out, you know, we as marketers are not definitely not an extinct breed. We just got to, you know, keep living our new JD to create a new JD. Or maybe, you know, we probably need to call ourselves as chief experience officers or something. Venu, you know, to your point, I'm absolutely with you that while the world thinks that digital recovery is the fundamental pillar, I think we human beings will still crave for human interaction and human touch and human experience. So clearly the future belongs to those enterprises and companies and brands who are able to see the consumer shift, right, and embrace that change. It really doesn't matter if you have been a 150-year-old multi-billion dollar enterprise or you are just a kid around the corner, Venu, as you pointed out, somebody created a local Twitter, right? So I think it's all about getting ready for the next normal. Do we really know what's the next normal? I guess we got to figure out. So thanks again, everyone. Really appreciate your time.
For more updates from CXO TV, please like and subscribe to our channel.